hearty and warm welcome to you all. Thank you to the organizers of this truly Namibian event. I know there are those that say we have been having too many oil and gas conferences in Namibia, and I think it's really those that say enough rhetoric, but I think it's really platforms like these that give concrete expression to the saying that if you ask me to chop down a tree, I will, and you give me 6 hours to chop down that tree, I'll probably spend the first 4 hours sharpening the axe and the remaining 2 hours chopping down the tree. So this is really industry's attempt to sharpen the axe and unlock the full potential of Namibia's oil and gas industry. Ladies and gentlemen, there's been a hype of activities on the Namibian continental shelf, and on behalf of NAMCOR, I have been tasked to set the scene to demonstrate Namibia's potential as an oil and gas producer in the global context. Now, this is a very enlightened audience, but there are also those that aren't very conversant with the oil and gas sector and probably want to understand the sector and how we essentially operate with a view of understanding the opportunities presented. So I'm going to spend 2.5 to 3 minutes of the allocated time just unpacking the value chain and NAMCOR's mandate essentially. So NAMCOR is a national oil company, a fully owned state enterprise. And we derive our mandate from the E&P Act of 1991 to carry out any process of refining, disposing, or dealing in petroleum products. And of course, we also derive some much of our mandate from the National Energy Policy of 2017 for the storage, importation, and marketing of petroleum products, essentially. And we operate the National Oil Storage Facility. We've been playing in the downstream space for the longest time. The downstream space, specifically trading in petroleum products. Obviously, this is a high-risk, low-reward business, especially at the back of market volatility. And the current volatility of crude and natural gas prices has resulted in companies reinventing themselves. And certainly, we have reinvested ourselves, and the tide is now turning towards the upstream endeavors, essentially. So, in as far as the upstream mandate is concerned, as per the E&P Act, we are expected to carry out reconnaissance operations, exploration, and production operations, essentially. So, just in a nutshell, I think there are many folks that try to really understand what is NAMCOR's role in the oil and gas discoveries. So across the oil and gas value chain, pre-exploration, we carry the Namibian state's interest in oil licenses issued in Namibia. So we carry interest anywhere from 10 to 80% essentially. And we partner with broadband technology operators who essentially shoot seismic data. This is really the process where geoscientists and geophysicists search for oil by conducting underground seismic gravitational magnetic tests, essentially. So what we do is we house this data in a data room, interpret the seismic, and carry out regional geological and geophysical studies of various acreages with a view of understanding prospectivity and selling this prospectivity. So when we move on to the exploration phase, we facilitate farm out opportunities of various acreage. So acreage is essentially these license blocks, and we partner with those that carry this sort of technical reservoir of knowledge to unlock the potential of Namibia's continental shelf, essentially. So we've essentially partnered with some of these super majors, namely Total, Shell, the Gulf, Indonesia, and other players in the market, and we work alongside them to shape and guide the appraisal programs. And I think it's important as a nation to understand what our role is essentially. So we sit alongside these super majors in the boardroom, And we understand the sort of geology that is associated with a particular well, and we contribute to informed decision making relating to budget or shooting a particular well, essentially. And this is important because if you don't manage that exploration costs, it eats up on your revenue, essentially. So it's in the state's enlightened self-interest to have an entity such as NAMCOR look out for that sort of interest. And of course, developing operatorship competencies in exploration. So we're branching now, following the appraisal, into the development phase. So the development phase is essentially preparing the oil field for production. So we're looking at ultra-deep water operations of 3,000 meters, 3 kilometers deep, close to 300 kilometers offshore. And of course, these are complex deep water operations that really require decades of experience to mine the oil, essentially. So ours is really to understand how we can build and develop competencies in that space, essentially. So we shape and guide field development plans, the case in point, the Kudu gas to power plant, which is at that advanced stage. And again, we facilitate secondments in the form of capacity building through hands-on deck capacity building, essentially, and participation. So the idea is to develop the sort of competencies that will allow NAMCOR to operate these complex oil fields in the not so distant future. We'll share the timeline. So once we get to production, so of course the end game is to get to first oil, revenue generation at first oil, so provide energy security opportunities. So we've seen good examples where the discoveries have subsidized oil and petroleum in various jurisdictions. This is where we facilitate local content through various products and service offerings, essentially. So this is where the value add is, essentially. I think an important endeavor is also, you know, facilitating lifetime extension of resources. So there's a polarity between longevity and revenue maximization. So the state might be interested in longevity, in ensuring that you have a elongated lifeline so that you have sustainability around employment and revenue, whereas an operator may be interested in maximizing revenue. So it's really about understanding where we can establish common ground. And of course, through NAMCOR's carried interest of 10% declaring dividends through these contributions, and of course contributing to the sovereign wealth fund. And of course, once these revenues start coming in, we're looking at identifying opportunities for reinvestment, sort of forward integration, looking further into midstream, and I'll share some of these opportunities with you shortly. And of course, identifying opportunities for improved cash flow management. So once you're able to manage that sort of productivity factor, you're able to affect the bottom line and channel better revenue to the state that can be dedicated towards socioeconomic development, essentially. And of course, last but not least, leverage green energies to mitigate carbon emissions as you go about your discoveries. So I'm not going to repeat what the Honourable Minister shared, but just to give you a sense, the market size of the sector is 6.9 trillion, and that's 3.8% of the global economy. And the industry is expected to grow by 4.9% to 7.3 trillion in 2023, effectively. So how long will this value lost? Talk about the sector. This is the conversation around the energy transition and the harmony between fossil fuels and the sustainable energies. So while the tide is gradually shifting towards renewable alternatives, the world depends on fossil fuels, in particular oil and gas, in a plethora of ways. And this is just to give you a sense. So 3,000 different kinds of products are made of oil. Petroleum products, as the more perceptive, you're looking at your ATO, which is your diesel, ERP, which is your petrol, gasoline, LSFO, and jet fuel. And of course, your crude in its raw form, can produce your top bitumen, kerogen, and you obviously use it to make products such as plastics, skate wheels, and so forth. And an interesting revelation is really, if you have ever had bubblegum, you know, the base, the petroleum base in bubblegum is actually the secret gum that actually creates that gum behavior. So luckily there are the ingredients to add sort of flavor. And obviously other perishables such as asphalt, lubricant, ink, cosmetics, and wax. So this is just to demonstrate to you that oil is more than just your sort of petroleum products. There are other derivative products that can flow from that oil. So how long will it last? We ask ourselves. NAMCOR, we've set up a department called the Sustainable Energies. It's really to manage the transition. So the argument, and we support the political principle orientation around a funded, paced, and just energy transition. Funded in the sense that the proceeds from oil will be used to fund the sustainable energies conversation, based in the sense that we do it over a specific period of time, give ourselves sufficient time to derive value from the resources that lay beneath our feet, and of course, just in the sense that we need to transition first from darkness to light and have a conversation around the transition. So just the history and overview of the discoveries. The Honorable Prime Minister shared, along with Mimenangula, and were cautioned not to repeat the information. But we're looking at five, essentially, I know the Commissioner says gigantic, but I'd like to call decent discoveries. So we have the Kudu Gas to Power Project that is currently ongoing, but the Graf, the Venus, and the Larana, and Jonker. And these four oil discoveries are essentially located in the Orange Basin. And there are other ongoing exploration and appraisal activities by the following operators: the Shell, Total Energies, BW, Kudu, ExxonMobil, Chevron, Gulf Energia, Rhino Resources. But these are just but a few that are operating. We obviously have a hype of activity with the other operators, essentially. So, as the more perceptive, the volumetrics around the discoveries in the oil industry, not only in Namibia, but the world over, is somewhat clouded by secrecy. And that's really because the organizations that are participating in these discoveries are listed on various exchanges, and any sort of information or misinformation can disrupt the stock market. So that's why we guarded jealously. But we commissioned a study with Wood Mackenzie, and these are the most conservative estimates. We're looking at about 11 billion barrels of reserve, and of course the Venus 1X discovery with 5.1 billion barrels. So towards the end of September we'll have more explicit numbers following the finalization of the appraisal campaigns, essentially. And then of course you can't come to a conference like this and not hear of any volumetrics, so those are the associated barrels. So just to give you a context, so these are proven crude reserves in Africa in 2021 by country. So Angola, as you can appreciate, the oil and gas industry in Angola has revolutionized the Angolan economy, and they're sitting on 7.78 barrels of oil, billion barrels of oil. And if you look at that relative to our discoveries, you're looking at least 11 billion with a population of 2.5 million. So you can just have an appreciation of how that will sort of revolutionize the Namibian economy. And of course, Libya, for political reasons, they're backing a tad bit, but they have got significant reserves of 48 billion barrels. The highest reserves in the world are sitting in Venezuela at 300 billion barrels. However, this is heavy oil, which is quite expensive and complex to extract from the ground, and the Honorable Minister, Prime Minister, indicated that we've got light oil, which is a much more better product to extract. So we've also got some facts around how these discoveries are located in relation to the global deepwater oil discoveries since 2015. So Guyana is the latest hotspot. So the Total Venus discovery is just below the Guyana discovery of 2015, essentially. Now, three of these four are in the top 30 deepwater discoveries since 2015, essentially. So these are just some key energy projects timeline. So you can see we're looking at going for FEED. So that's the front end engineering design. We're busy with that for Kutu. So NAMCOR has been working alongside BW Kutu. And we're looking at FID for Kutu for the gas to power project sometime in the third quarter of 2024, essentially. And of course, there are efforts from the operators to expedite to first oil for the Total and Shell discoveries, essentially. And conservative estimates suggest that by sometime between 2029 and 2030, we are looking at first oil. But obviously, these timelines keep changing as you get a better appreciation of the reservoir. So, in terms of the phases, I think the phase where we are at now, we likely to require a light touch in Namibia. So, the phase that we are at right now, we're looking at 2021 to 2026, arguably. We will be seeing very limited value because you have operators setting up in-country offices, but the recruitment is limited to primarily administrative and logistical positions. And of course, given the fact that we haven't finalized the appraisal campaigns, essentially. But phase two is probably the exciting one. And the Ministry of Mines and Energy has already started the process of developing a local content policy. And that is really aimed at unlocking the sort of indirect and induced benefits associated with the discoveries, essentially through products and services to support the oil and gas industry. So between 2026 and 2032, we will see local benefits prior to production peak when project revenues start streaming in. And then of course, phase three, that's post-peak benefits and economic impact. That need to be sustainable in the Namibian economy to avoid an over-reliance on oil and gas, essentially. So then this is the conversation around the economic impacts of the discovery. So we've essentially got three impacts: the direct impacts, indirect benefits, and the induced benefits. The direct benefits relate to the revenue that is associated from the proceeds of oil and the employment that is created. The indirect benefits relate to the sort of local content, products and services that serve to support the industry, and the induced benefits are essentially as a result of this increase in spending within the economy, you have an increase in household income that has a spillover on other economic activities, essentially. So there's a very interesting discussion in public dialogue, and that's around government stake. So in as much as NAMCOR carries 10% of the state's interest through carried interest. So carried interest essentially means that you don't pay up until a certain point in time, whether it's before development or post-production, essentially. So if you look at the cumulative value that is accrued to the state, you're looking at about 54%. So 5% royalty, and you're looking at tax, petroleum tax of about 35%. And if you couple that with NAMCOR stake, you're looking at anywhere between 53 and 56%, essentially. And of course, other additional windfall taxes of 5 to 12% that are essentially negotiable. So that is the value that is accrued to the state. And when we have a conversation around the oil and its contribution to the sector, to the socio-economic development, this is the conversation we can essentially have. So that's just how the government take compares with other jurisdictions. So we compare quite well. If you look at Guyana, they've got 2% of royalty, whereas ours is 5%. This is just conversation around the CAPEX spend that our Right Honourable Minister referred to. We speak of the economic benefits in as far as GDP impact is concerned. So there's an expectation that these discoveries will double Namibia's GDP by 2040 to close to $37 billion, and of course at peak, with these conservative estimates, and these are just conservative estimates, we're looking at about 3,600 to 4,000 direct jobs essentially created by the sector. So indirect and induced benefits, so these are the spillover industries across the oil and gas value chain. So within the core of the onion, we're looking at your more technical services, so well services, ring hire that really requires sophisticated operatorship competencies. And you, as you go into the outer space of the onion, you look at more of the sort of available resources in country that can participate in the discovery. So whether it's freight services, electrical engineering, maintenance, and so forth. So Deloitte is at the instruction of the Ministry of Mines and Energy busy with a baseline study to understand the sort of skills that are required and the sort of industries that will be created by the sector. And that's probably how entrepreneurs and service companies can position themselves. So I think before I end off, I think an important conversation to be had is really around the resource curse. So the resource curse, I think, this is probably underplayed. In economics, as an economics lecturer, so it's referred to as the Dutch disease, and this is really the apparent causal relationship between the increase in economic development in a particular sector, for instance, oil, we have a discovery, and then, of course, a decline in other sectors such as manufacturing, essentially. So because the sector offers significant premiums, everybody and all businesses, human resource capacity is concentrated in the petroleum sector and suffocates other aspects of the economy, essentially. And the term was coined in 1977, where you had a decline in manufacturing sector in the Netherlands after the discovery of large natural gas in the Groningen field in 1959. Of course, generally, the resource curse is caused by too much of the country's capital and labor force concentrated in a particular jurisdiction. So, just to give you a typical example, so once you have a country whose fiscal break-even oil price is essentially high, you run the risk of the resource curse. So an oil exporting country's fiscal break-even oil price is the minimum price per barrel that the country needs in order to meet its expected spending needs while balancing its budget, essentially. So if you've got effectively a country such as Algeria, so you can see that the projections in 2021, in order for them to balance their budget, the oil price must be $169.6 US per barrel, essentially. This is a significant challenge for them, because if the oil price tanks, essentially, then you've got a deficit in the budget, essentially. So rounding up. So how do we leverage the oil discoveries? Well, 1 minute and we'll wrap up. So the conversation around integrating further midstream, so we take our cues from the recently developed draft ownership policy, the state ownership policy, to determine the extent of participation for NAMCOR. So there are three precincts that determine the participation of a commercial enterprise. One is to correct market failure or gaps in the market. Second is to ensure the ownership, exploitation, and management of key natural resources, for instance, petroleum resources. And three is to safeguard economic interest. And we believe that the opportunities that we're looking at, we're in the process of developing a 10 to 15 year master plan, and there are low-hanging fruits that are associated with these discoveries. The first conversation is around the pipeline. So these are obviously offshore operations that are 300 kilometers offshore, and there's an opportunity. So we traveled to Norway a month ago, and we got an appreciation that Norway has about 8,800 kilometers of pipeline. So this is an entire steel industry. And with Namibia's iron ore capacity, you can leverage that and transition your raw material and create sort of an industry. So those are the conversations we're looking at. The other conversation is around a refinery. We had a visit to Angola around at the back of a cabinet resolution at looking at equity into the Lobito refinery. They are constructing a refinery of about 200,000 barrels per day, essentially. And if we can look at that opportunity locally and see whether we have the sort of critical mass to support that refinery, essentially. So and obviously the capital outlay is exceptionally expensive for a 100,000 barrel per day refinery, looking at about 1.5 billion US dollars, essentially. The other conversation is around the retail network. So you have your crude, and now you want to expand further downstream, and there's a case to be had around whether NAMCOR should actually be participating in the retail space. And of course, that's another conversation to be had. Perhaps the lowest hanging fruit is around the logistics space. So we've entered into a conversation to look at the possibility of setting up a oil and gas logistics base. And the challenge with the offshore operations is that you have a situation where much of the activity is offshore. So you want a situation where you can consolidate the industry, and the logistics base is one such platform to ensure that you, you unlock the full potential of the sector, essentially. The capacity building is an important one. And in conclusion, there is a need for a policy statement of the Namibian oil and gas sector. So this policy statement is essentially the ideological dispensation of the state in terms of what they seek to achieve from the sector, from which all policy strategies and initiatives will flow. And of course, we need to unpack and understand the oil and gas value chain. This will enable the country to leverage the immediate opportunities that are presented by the sector. And ultimately, investor policy certainty is essential for a conducive business working environment and critical to the success of the industry. So ladies and gentlemen, Namibia is a powerhouse, and as NAMCOR, we remain committed to being the Namibian state's vehicle that will help the country's economic potential, given the wealth lying beneath our feet. I thank you.